So, as the epidemiology and etiology has already been discussed, so I'm not going into that. So, in the past decade or so, researchers throughout the world has been working and in analyzing transcriptome data to come up with markers that can predict prognosis, diagnosis, and of course the treatment strategies. And one of the modes that they are using is transcriptomics. So what is transcriptomics? It's a study of transcriptome, that is the complete set of RNA transcripts that are produced by the genome under specific circumstances or in a specific cell, using tools like microarrays or RNA sequencing, known as RNA-seq. So the complete set of RNA transcripts include both the classical RNAs, that is mRNA, RNA, dRNA, as well as non-coding RNAs like miRNA and long non-coding RNAs. So what are the tools that you can use to study transcriptome? So there are four tools here: RNA sequencing, microarray, SAGE, that is serial analysis for gene expression, and quantitative RT-PCR. And you can see here that RNA sequencing, SAGE, and qPCR are quantitative, while microarray is qualitative technique, and that is why most people, after doing microarray, validate set of genes with real-time PCR. So the two techniques that have come up in the area of transcriptomics are microarray and RNA sequencing. In microarray, there is a hybridization of the oligonucleotide probes with fluorescent-labeled complementary DNA, which allows for the quantitative measurement of amount of RNA transcript. While in RNA sequencing, RNA is first converted into a library of cDNA fragments with adapter placed on both one end or both hands, and each molecule is then sequenced via deep sequencing with or without amplifiers to obtain short sequences. There are advantages of RNA sequencing over microarray, that is, they directly sequence cDNA, which is not limited to detecting previously identified genes, as you do in microarrays. RNA-seq better detects lower abundance transcripts, and it provides direct access to transcript sequence. And when you are comparing genomic data with transcriptomic data of the same individual, it can reveal RNA reading events, small insertion, deletions, and information about exons are connected. So I will now discuss or come up to some studies where they have used transcriptome approaches and have shown that the output, that is the set of genes that are differentially expressed in cancer as compared to normal, can be used in either prognosis or diagnosis or in the treatment of the disease, specifically head and neck cancer. Okay. So this is the first study that I'm going to discuss, where the author has run a meta-analysis of gene expression data, and they classified head and neck cancer subtypes with biological and clinical relevances. So what they did, they carried out head and neck squamous cell carcinoma genome-wide gene expression profiling on 20 data sets available. In training set, they have 8 data sets, while in validation set, they have 12 independent data sets. And what they found is 6 clusters of differentially expressed gene that are stratified, and they classified as cluster 1 to cluster 6. And then later they gave a final designation, like cluster 2 was given mesenchymal, cluster 3 was given hypoxia, cluster 5 was given classical, and so on. And they found also oncosignature that is distinct to these subtypes, and the functional pathways that are associated with the that is associated with these phenotypes. And then they later compared their genome-wide molecular pattern with already published subtypes like Wolter labels and Chung labels, and you can see that HPV-like and immunoreactive type actually correspond to atypical. Mesenchymal is mesenchymal, hypoxia and defense response is basal, and classical is the same. Author also ran survival analysis by Kaplan-Meier, and they found that cluster 1, which is like HPV-like, is showing positive prognosis, while cluster 2 and 3, like mesenchymal and hypoxia, they have bad prognosis. So this is another study where the author have looked into serum mRNA, which we call cRNA or circulating RNA, in head and neck squamous cell carcinoma. So in brief, they compared a non-recurrent tumor with a recurrent tumor, and they found a set of 6 genes that was repressed in non-recurrent tumor and found to be induced in recurrent tumors. One is ARAG, it's amphilaglin, it's a ligand for EGFR, and ARAG gene silencing and binding inhibition prevents EGFR phosphorylation, and it's downstream signaling. The another one is INHBA, which is inhibiting beta A, subunit of homodimer activity A that stimulates VEGF expression. And the other one is CCL20, and it activates ERK kinase signaling through MMP dependent release of amphiaraglin and transaminase of EGF. So these genes basically regulate pathways like EGFR, VEGF, of course they regulate MMPs, and that's why they are involved in invasion and the proliferation of this disease. So these markers are useful in the routine care of head and neck squamous cell carcinoma. By monitoring these circulating RNAs during the follow-up might suggest that tumor relapse. This is another study performed by Zia et al, where they use a different platform known as RT-profiler PCR array, where they have looked for 84 genes, and they found these 20 genes which are upregulated in metastasis and recurrence, and they pinned down to 12 genes, and they say that it can predict the metastasis and the recurrence in head and neck squamous cell carcinoma. And these are the other two studies showing different sets of genes which are associated with the nodal metastasis compared to primary tumors. And this study was performed in 2005, where they developed 102 gene signatures that predict propensity of lymph node metastasis. However, the predictor only able to directly determine status in 61 out of 82 patients. We know that hypoxia is a very important factor in cancer progression, and hypoxic cells are resistant to radiotherapy. So this is a study published by Danish Head and Neck Cancer Group, and they pinned down 15 hypoxia-responsive genes, and they have basically segregated head and neck cancer into more hypoxic and less hypoxic on the basis of these 15 hypoxia-responsive genes, and they show that in more hypoxic tumors, where these hypoxic responsive genes are present, when a radiosensitive agent, nimberazole, was given, they have a better disease specific survival as compared to less hypoxic tumors. This is another study. As we look in the, like previous speaker told about the Warburg effect, that most solid cancer has high glycolytic flux, that is, they take more glucose. And this glucose is converted to lactate, which actually affects cancer cell migration and invasion. So this group looked into different lactate transporter in head and neck cancer using an online tool, and they found that out of 10 GLUT, that is glucose transporter, only one, that is GLUT4, is overexpressed in HNSCC. And they validated this data using Oncomine tool, and they found that GLUT4 is the only gene that is significantly correlated with metastasis in head and neck cancer. So what they did, they did online analysis, and they found that GLUT4 mRNA expression is significantly associated with the poor survival rates. They validated this with immunohistochemistry on their patients, and they found that GLUT4 high expression has patients show poor overall survival. Now, I'm a basic scientist, so I spend a lot of time in lab, and I am working on the area of Wnt signaling. What are Wnts? Basically, these are 16-bit glycoproteins, so they are ligands. They are secreted by the cells. They go outside and bind to the neighboring cells or the same cells. So basically, they activate autokine or pyrukinin signaling. They are found to be deregulated in various cancers. And Wnts, if you look, there are 19 ligands. And they regulate proliferation, differentiation, migration, and invasion in cancer cells. While I was doing my postdoctoral research, we found that a ligand known as Wnt5a has been involved in melanoma. So basically, this Wnt5a significantly increases melanoma cell migration and invasion. And inhibition of this can actually inhibit melanoma cell metastasis. So during one of the conferences, we found this poster where they show that using a transcriptomic approach, where they look at microenvironmental microarray screen, and they found that this Wnt5a signaling in head and neck squamous cell carcinoma is linked with lymph node metastasis. This is a paper we published recently in 2017, where we show that Wnt5a protein is overexpressed in oral squamous cell carcinoma compared to dysplasia and oral because of its normal appearance. We found that Wnt5a expression in normal mucosa is restricted only to nucleus, but in dysplasia and in cancer, it is coming out, it is in the cytoplasm and released outside in extracellular environment. We went back in vitro and showed that taking two oral cancer cell lines, that if you give Wnt5a, these cell lines respond because they increase their cytosolic free calcium. That is the hallmark of Wnt5a signaling. We further show that Wnt5a actually is not regulating the proliferation of the cell, but is involved in the migration of the cell. So it can very well go with the data that was presented in the poster that it is involved in lymph node metastasis because migration is increased. So now that we have developed a Wnt5a antagonistic peptide, we now call it Box5, and we have shown that it inhibits Wnt5a signaling in melanoma cells. We use this peptide in oral cancer cells. As you can see here and appreciate that, when we give recombinant Wnt5a, the migration of these cells increases. However, in the presence of Box5, which is an antagonistic peptide, basically there is utilization of this migration. We further show in melanoma that Wnt5a actually can be regulated by IL-6 in a positive feedback loop, and we now show that a paper is coming up in OncoTarget in a month, where we show that Wnt5a IL-6 dual inhibition can inhibit melanoma cell migration. In oral cancer also, it is something like that. We found Wnt5a is overexpressed, and then there are reports also of increased interleukin 6 expression. So what currently we are doing is that we are looking at Wnt5a IL-6 feedback loop in oral squamous cell carcinoma, and then whether this combined targeting of Wnt5a antagonistic peptide with IL-6 neutralizing antibody can help in the treatment of oral cancer. Thanks.